Welcome to Best Practices in Leadership in Riverside County. I'm Terry Wilhelm with the Leadership Institute of Riverside County. With me is Joe Balleweg, Principal of Great Oak High School in Temecula Valley Unified School District. Joe was our Principal of the Year in 2011, been Principal at Great Oak High School for 5 years, and has been a staff member there for 8 years. Joe is here today to share specifically with us about student interventions that have been put in place at Great Oak. Student interventions are the way that a school responds when students have difficulty learning. So, Joe, give us a little background about Great Oak. How many students do you have? What are the demographics? And what were the student needs that you were noticing that prompted you to begin putting these interventions in place?
Great Oak High School is a comprehensive high school. We have this year, our population continues to grow. This year we're actually pushing 3,500 students, so we're a fairly large school. Demographically, we serve the suburbs. We are the southernmost city in Riverside County, and we actually are the southernmost school in that city. We have a typical collection of students, and where we run the gamut of free and reduced lunch students, students with special needs, running all the way up through fully run AP and IB programs.
Can you explain AP and IB for some of our audience members that might not be familiar with those acronyms?
Sure, and I'll start with IB. IB is the most rigorous, comprehensive program we offer academically on our campus, and it stands for International Baccalaureate Program, and it is a course of a program of high rigor, where students take a certain number of courses across the disciplines, and so they are taking the highest level of rigor in their foreign language, their English, their home language, their mathematics, their science, and then electives.
How does the term International Baccalaureate, what does that really mean? Is it an international program?
Yeah, it's a program where the curriculum itself is dictated from a central agency, the IBO, and it is a worldwide program, so it is truly global. What students are studying at an IB campus in Southern California would be the same thing that they're studying in an IB campus in Africa.
Okay. And AP?
And then the AP, which is a little bit more well-known, stands for Advanced Placement. And it is, once again, a very highly rigorous program. The difference between AP and IB is, in AP, if you happen to be a math science student, you would take very rigorous program or courses in the math or in the science discipline, as opposed to IB, where you would be taking it, if you're a full diploma student, across the disciplines.
And then if students complete those AP courses, I understand there's a test that they take, and how does that work?
Yeah, and once again, one more difference between the two programs. In the Advanced Placement program, students will sit for a 3-hour exam in May, and they sit for one assessment, which is externally scored, and the student will get a score back according to how they did in that 3-hour sitting. In the IB program, students actually sit for multiple assessments per discipline, each year. And so one of the big differences is that students in the IB program will sit for a series of assessments, whereas in the AP program they sit for one.
Just the one for the course that they've signed up for.
Correct.
And so if they pass the advanced placement test, say for calculus, then what does that do for them when they go on to college?
And that's a multifaceted answer. Probably the simplest answer is, depending on the college that they go to, they can, depending on the score they receive, get college credit. And there are some students who, should they take, depending on the number that they take, enough, they actually enter college with maybe their first semester or their freshman year credits taken care of, some even into where they enter college with sophomore status. Mm-hmm. I think the more complex and, to me, of greater value is the fact that they enter college very well prepared mm-hmm. for a highly rigorous program, which college is. They are incredibly well-versed in how to study, in being close readers, in being really good writers, and very importantly, they can discuss. So they carry a level of confidence with them in regard to academics into college that you don't see typically from your normal student.
Mm-hmm. So Joe, it was interesting to me hearing about all the interventions you had put in place, because with the reputation of Great Oak and having these really rigorous programs, the IB program, which not that many high schools have, although AP is more common, as you said, you saw the need once you became principal, or perhaps before that, to put some interventions in place. So tell me a little bit about how that got started. How did you, what prompted you to say, you know, we need to do put some interventions in place, and then how did you involve the staff in that work?
And I think it's really nice to start by talking about the AP and the IB programs, and to start with the most rigorous academic programs you have on your campus. We made a decision early on at our site, prior to opening, that our AP and IB programs would not have gates, that we would, anyone who wanted in after a informed conversation with staff members would be able to take those courses, whether they be the AP courses or a full-blown IB candidate. So in that sense, there's not an application process, there are not prerequisites. With that being the case, we saw that we had a large number of students that were going to attempt these courses. That's great, obviously, that you want your students to be challenged, and you want all of your students to reach for and stretch their academic abilities. In doing that, what we found fairly early on was that meant we needed to increase our levels of support for students. So I think oftentimes when people think of intervention, they think of students who just aren't getting it, who aren't being successful. I think that we need to think, and at Great Oak High School, we have thought bigger in the sense that interventions are for all students across your campus. And so it was driven across all the spectrums of campus, from the top levels to your IS students, to your students who fall, quote unquote, in the middle. And what we found early on was we needed to create a system of support. We found that we had pockets on our campus of teachers that were very willing to spend extra time with students, to invite students before school, at lunch, after school, in order to intervene when they struggled. And what we wanted to do was tap into the things that they were doing, but to do it systematically across our campus, so that it didn't really depend if you're a student at Great Oak High School. It didn't matter whether you had the most rigorous schedule. It didn't matter which teachers you had. What you knew, one of the givens was, if you struggled, there was help and there was support. And so we really early on strove to guarantee learning on our campus for all of our students. And then we kind of, making learning the guarantee, we made time the variable, and then began to figure out ways to allow that to happen systematically.
Can I back up for just a minute? You mentioned IS students. What students are those?
Instructional support. And so commonly they would be your RSP or your SDC students, your students with special needs. And on our campus, we just call it instructional support.
Okay. So those are students typically have a learning disability?
So they're on an individual educational plan or an IEP.
Okay. Correct. So you mentioned that you have teachers, or you had teachers, I'm sure you have probably even more now, who were willing to give their own time before and after school, at lunch. Typically when schools begin that way, which is a great way to start, kind of volunteer basis, sometimes the kids that really need to stay after school or come early or come in at lunch, they don't come in.
Right.
So what were your next steps to build on that?
Okay, and so what we had to do as a staff is we had to come to the realization that, and I'm going to back up a little bit, that we had a vision as a school, and that our vision was that every student at Great Oak High School will reach his or her full learning potential. And our staff was bought into it. We did a lot of work in those first 3 years.
That was your mission statement?
It was our vision statement.
Vision
yes.
statement.
It was our mission, you could say, that we would do everything we could do as a school system to get all of our students, every single one of them, to reach their fullest learning potential and to be successful on our campus. And for us, success equaled learning, and so that all of our students would learn. Once again, regardless of the academic track that they were following independently. And so once we established that vision, and that it wasn't just a sign on the wall or something that we said, but it was truly something that our staff members believed in, we then had to say, if that is what we believe in, if that's what we want to become, if that's what we want to do, what are we doing in our day-to-day actions, our moment-to-moment actions with our students to make that come to life? And so we had some very serious conversations, both in whole staff, and we're a large school, as I said, with 3,500 students.
How large is the staff?
We have over 130 teachers, so our teaching staff is large. So we had a lot of conversation in big group, whole staff, about that fact, about here's what we want to become in regard to learning with our students. How do we get there? And then we would use the accordion model, and then also within leadership groups, where every single discipline on our campus, every group of teachers was represented in those groups, we would have smaller group discussions where we would push some ideas forward. What's our current reality on our campus? And we realized our current reality was intervention happens in pockets, and it happens by invitation. But it's not directed. And so we basically got a really good idea of what our current reality was, and then we presented that to our whole staff, what that current reality was. And then we decided that we're gonna get very serious about this. And we created a team of people that we call their intervention committee, once again, where every group, program, and discipline on our campus was represented. And we went out and we visited schools. We visited schools in both San Diego and Orange County that publicized the fact that they had an intervention program, that they had a program that provided timely, systematic, school-wide, and directed, not invitational, intervention to their students. And so we went out to see those schools. And members of that committee went, received information, came back informed by what they saw, and then in turn informed our subgroup. And then that subgroup continued to go out and inform our entire staff on the things that they saw.
So after we take a break, we're going to come back and hear what your next steps were from those field trips and that all that data gathering. Okay. So please join us in a minute, and we will continue the journey at Great Oak High School putting student interventions in place.
The Leadership Institute of Riverside County was formed by Superintendent Ken Young to provide leadership development for the 23 school districts served by the Riverside County Office of Education so that all students will graduate ready for college and the workforce. In addition, the Institute supports internal departments at RCOE and has expanded its services to include clients from Riverside County businesses and nonprofit and government agencies. These clients may participate in the Institute's signature programs for leadership development or may contract with the Institute for customized services. Contact Dr. Hilma Griffin-Watson, Executive Director of the Leadership Institute, to discuss your leadership needs.
Welcome back. We are back with Joe Balleweg, and he has just finished describing the field trips and the investigations the staff did to look at other schools that were doing interventions, and here is what they did with that information. So the next steps, Joe.
So what our committee was informed, and they, in essence, decided first and foremost, in order for our interventions to be successful and to make an impact on our students systematically, we need to look at our master schedule. And in looking at the master schedule, there were some non-negotiables, so to speak, from our staff that we needed to do. And one of them was our staff, we knew that we needed a time period during the day where students would be mandated, directed to go to receive intervention as opposed to inviting them. And so we knew we had to carve a time out during our school day. That was one. Two was they wanted that intervention time period to be as flexible as possible in the sense that as a student, if I needed help, I was struggling with a concept in my chemistry course, I could go to a chemistry teacher to get information on how to come to better understanding with that concept, as opposed to being locked into the schedule where I was going to this specific room every day for intervention, where it may have happened that I needed help in chemistry, but I happened to be in a room with someone who was an English teacher or a social science teacher. So they wanted the flexibility in that respect. They also, it was very important to the staff that there was flexibility where they didn't necessarily feel like the intervention period was another period in their school day where they had to plan for it every single day.
Yeah.
And so those three were very important tenets to the program that we felt that we wanted to build. So the first part of it, the master schedule, we were blessed with the fact that when our school opened, we believed very strongly in getting our kids to read. And so we had a 20-minute period of time during our day where our entire campus shut down and we all read, staff and students.
Okay.
So we had that 20 minutes built in. Mm-hmm. And as many people know, silent reading is a great intervention in and of itself. So we had that in our schedule. We decided to grow that by 10 minutes. And so we took a few minutes out of every period and shortened our periods to grow this period during the day, the silent sustained reading period. We took it from 20 minutes to 30 minutes in order to really be able to give a valuable intervention, to intervene with students who were struggling, we needed at least 30 minutes time. And we learned that from our trips to the other schools. So we put into place a 30-minute period of time on our campus. It goes from 9:40 until 10:10, where we provide intervention and enrichment for our students. The second part was the flexibility end of it. As I said, it was really important for teachers that students were able to go to the experts where they were struggling.
Right. Yeah.
And so we devised a way for students to be able to, at 9:40, when that time period began, they can go to, in essence, where they need to go in order to get the intervention that they need to get with some guidelines. We invented a system of passes where teachers would come together and decide that we need in our team of chemistry, we need to provide we have a group of students who's struggling with this particular concept. And so how many do you have? How many do you have? How many do you have within the team? We may decide that we have 30 students who are not quite understanding this concept.
And this is preventive. This is not after the fact.
And so we're teaching this concept this week. We have this many students who aren't understanding it. We're going to go ahead and give an intervention, and we're going to invite these 30 students through this pass, this intervention ticket. They will receive the ticket at the beginning of the week, and then they know that for this particular intervention, on Tuesday and Wednesday, we're going to be in this room in order to receive help from our
Do you have any students
teacher.
That don't take you up on the invitation?
It's not an option. So once they're invited,
it's a mandatory invitation.
Yes, they show up. And then, of course, not all students are as happy to show up as others, and so there is some monitoring that takes place through the PASS system, and then if need be, counseling and discipline for students who don't show up. What we found, however, is that that's not an option, or actually not an option. That doesn't happen. Our students have been very appreciative of the fact that they know when they go to those interventions, they're getting really sound instruction in the specific area that they need, mm-hmm. and they walk out learning and feeling like they can now step back into the classroom right on pace with everybody else. And so we were able to provide our students with more time so that the learning becomes the constant. And it is a little more complex than that, but it achieved the flexibility needs mm-hmm. that our staff had. Mm-hmm. So our staff creates across the board, obviously not just chemistry, but across the board every day, they create situations where they can teach these intervention lessons on a daily basis. On the flexibility side for teachers, if they don't need to intervene on a specific concept on this day because they're not ready to, they silent read for the 30 minutes with their students. And so we have a built-in silent reading program that is enhanced by the specific interventions mm-hmm. that are needed.
Mm-hmm.
And it works incredibly well in that respect, that when a teacher is not ready to provide or it's not needed to provide a specific intervention, the class reads.
And I know that your teachers give common assessments. The chemistry team will give a common assessment,
right.
Algebra 1, ninth grade English. Talk more about that and how the system of interventions works with these assessments and the results of that.
So as with so many schools in our age of accountability in education, we have begun to work as a professional learning mm-hmm. community, as a campus. And so within our campus, we have a variety of teams. And those teams work together toward a common goal. And so we have certainly taken the standards, unpacked the standards, found the essential standards, and we created assessments off of those. And those assessments are given commonly among that team of teachers. It is termed a non-negotiable among teachers that they will give those assessments at the time that they have as a team decided they will give them. They happen every 4 to 6 weeks, and they do guide the instruction, mm-hmm. because obviously as a member of that team, you know that your particular group of students in that subject area will be testing on this, on these concepts at this time, and so it's going to guide your instruction leading up to that. So all of our disciplines work in teams such as that and give common assessments every 4 to 6 weeks. Those common assessments then obviously create data, and from that data we're able to see which students are being successful, which are not. We move in with intervention obviously at that time. We're also able to see, which has been a great benefit as well, which teachers tend to have students who score higher in specific concepts or specific areas. We then highlight those teachers to be able to obviously share their practices uh-huh. in a sharing of best practices scenario when they meet as a team. They may look at the data and realize that teacher A and teacher B seem to be really, really strong. Their students do very well in this concept. What are you guys doing as teachers in order to have your students perform at the level that you're performing?
So that helps the whole team.
Exactly. So you see that the entire instruction on the campus begins to rise as you share those practices. It also allows you to identify the students that are struggling mm-hmm. and provide further intervention for them. But we also don't wait for 4 to 6 weeks to provide intervention. So on a daily basis, obviously, we are formatively assessing our students. Yeah. And at that time, the teachers decide, I know we have this pocket of kids who are struggling with this. We're going to go create this very specific intervention for that. And those are happening on a week-to-week basis throughout. Yeah. One of the benefits that we also have in our district is that our teachers have, on a weekly basis, every Monday morning, they have an hour and 15 minutes to meet as a team and make these decisions, build their intervention lessons together, look at data and decide which students need that intervention or which pocket of students need enrichment, create their intervention tickets and passes so that they know which students.
So it's a late start day on a Monday, the kids come later?
The kids do show up later on.
Tell us a little bit about your SOS program.
To supplement the intervention program, which is very strategic and concept learning specific, we do have students on our campus that unfortunately aren't maybe as academically committed or have missed assignments. Uh-huh. They're not, as we term it, doing the do part of it. And so we
some
do
of it's motivation with these students?
Some of it's motivation. Some of it maybe is life after school gets in the way. Mm-hmm. And maybe they don't have a quiet place to go home and do the things that they need to do academically. Maybe they have some commitments at home, need to watch brothers and sisters, need to take on jobs in order to help the family. And so our SOS program actually is a program that is run through our administrative team. And during the intervention time, that half hour when our teachers are either silent reading with students or providing skill-specific intervention, administratively, we run an SOS program. Our teachers sign students up via the internet. We're actually moving to Google Docs where they sign kids up because they have missed an assignment or more. And so a teacher can sign a student up. It goes to a central location where administratively we divide those students who are signed up for missing assignments among us. And we work in teams of two where those students go to room with us and we basically crack the whip and nag them to get their stuff done.
Perfect job for an administrator.
Yes. So we've taken that part on and we, as soon as that student finishes that assignment that they've been signed up for SOS for, they go back to the teacher. The teacher looks at the assignment, signs them off, and then they're released from SOS. That particular program is the 30 minutes of intervention. There's also 10 minutes prior to intervention that's their break, and students in the SOS program lose their break. So it's 40 minutes of them Tuesday through Friday working on the assignments that they've missed.
So it's definitely a consequence.
And losing their break, which is
well,
the consequence.
Yes. Well, we're out of time, Joe. We didn't even get to hear about the Freshman Sophomore Academy, but I would encourage anyone who is interested to hear more about interventions at Great Oak High School, including the Freshman Sophomore Academy, which is sort of the newest piece of the puzzle, to contact Joe. And Joe, your email would be?
It's long. J Balleweg, B-A-L-L-E-W-E-G, at tvusd.k12.ca.us.
So, thank you for joining us for Best Practices in Leadership in Riverside County.